consider myself a visual artist, kind of in general. I work across media with video, photography, drawing, sound, text. So I don't have a kind of medium-specific practice. And often I combine these mediums within one work or within one installation. I mean, research is an important part of my practice, and I'm quite interested in the figure of the artist as researcher and what that means as opposed to other types of researchers or kind of academic research or traditional research, and the types of freedom I have or I allow myself to have as an artist to conduct research which might tap into other types of research, but then I have the freedom of association, and I can connect things that maybe traditionally wouldn't be connected. For me, site visits or kind of field work or whatever one might call it, or just a research visit, is one of the most important aspects. And quite often I would go sort of almost blindly to a place without knowing a lot about it, but with a particular interest already, or perhaps even open. Through the research visit, I realize what I want to make work about. But quite often, the histories or places I'm interested in are not necessarily archived. So I did this piece around the Suez Canal, around the story of 14 cargo ships that were trapped in the Suez Canal for 8 years, amongst them also British, German, French ships. And this is not archived anymore, because it was briefly in the news at the time, but it's not considered a historical event that's worthy of kind of record. I contacted the shipping companies, and through the shipping companies I found individual crew members who were on those ships that were stuck in the Suez Canal, and I visited them in their countries at home, and through them I found a lot of material. I collected a lot of material, photographs, films, stories. So in a sense, the first step was to create an archive, and then out of that archive I created a work which is only using a small fraction of that archive. One of the kind of interesting things about it was that the material I started to collect was really manifest in various technologies. So I had Super 8 films, I had slides, I had photographic prints, I had kind of oral history. And for me it became an important aspect of the work to consider the materiality of those images. And that was something that fed into the final work. So I tried to translate and use the original materiality, the original technology, within the work I presented. So I would include Super 8 footage and slides and HD footage that I filmed on site in the same video that was projected in the exhibition. And you might even hear the sound of the slide projector, or the sound of the 16mm projector or the 8mm projector. For me, that's an important aspect where I'm interested in the information that's contained in images beyond what they represent, the material information, the tactile information. That is also something about history. It also tells us something about history. It also tells us something about the context, about how they're kept, about deterioration. A lot of the slides had scratches and dust particles, and I became particularly interested in those and the landscape that was drawn through those particles. I see my work as a dialogue with the world we live in. I sort of feel that artists also over history have always engaged with the world that they live in, and try to understand it and try to look at it and try to represent it. And in my case, I'm particularly interested in the way history seeps into the present, in the way we are affected by history. So when my work deals with a kind of historical episode or event, I'm not actually interested in the past of that event, in the history of that event, but in the way that it affects us today, in the way it might have connections to things that are happening today. There is, of course, also a conversation within art and with other artists who perhaps work on similar issues or similar ideas or have similar methodologies. But I wouldn't say that my work itself is about art, it's about the world. I guess as an art student, the kind of earliest works that I remember being kind of struck by was Susan Hiller's in the Freud Museum, where I was really interested and intrigued with the way that she constructed a kind of parallel collection to Freud's collection of artifacts that managed to produce a commentary on Freud's collection and obviously on the relationship between art and anthropology and the world. I really loved Rothko's Seagram commission that was then at the Tate Britain, exhibited at Tate Britain in a special room, and the way that a kind of, in a sense, completely silent image, non-representational image, can create a space for which is evoking something. And then I guess a third sort of type of practice I was always interested in was Robert Smithson's work, yeah, which is sort of part of land art, but is sort of engaging with land, but also with its history and architecture and what he calls ruins in reverse, contemporary ruins, which evoke a different kind of temporality. So these, I guess, were sort of my earliest influences as an art student. Well, I guess there are lots of influences outside of art in relation to methodologies, but also in relation to kind of ideas that I might refer to or use within the work. Something else I'm interested in is obviously the kind of methodologies that ethnographers have been using, and also questioning those methodologies. What it means when you go to a foreign place, when you engage with a foreign culture, what is your role within that, what are the power relations, what kind of gaze do you bring to bear upon a place. So I've been sort of thinking quite extensively about that. More recently, I've also become interested in the work of Avery Gordon around haunting and ghosts, and the way she describes ghosts as something that comes from the past, that's unfinished business, basically, that comes back to haunt us because we need to deal with it. And the way it comes back is as a representation, is representing itself, but it's not fully present, so it asks a lot of questions. And I suppose in my work, I sort of think in a similar way about how I can relate to these questions and how my work can open up these questions. So in relation to this unmade film project, the fact that it can't be a film, that it can't be a coherent whole that we can watch from beginning to end, that has a linearity that we're used to from films, obviously has to do with the story of that place, that it is a haunted place and it sort of shows itself in fragments, and the film itself almost has broken apart before it's even come together. And we need to put it together in our own minds as viewers. The viewers need to put it together in their minds. So, which is a sort of transfer of the film that's there in the space, in its elements, in its kind of constituent elements, and then transferred and in a sense constructed within the viewer. So it demands a kind of complicity of the viewer. I'm quite interested also in Pasolini talked about the script, in a sense, as a medium between the film and the story. And it projects internally, it makes you project a film in your own head. So it demands this kind of complicity. So it's a similar mode, it's a similar mechanism from a script to the film. Yeah, there are lots of artworks that I feel a very strong affinity with, but they're not necessarily works that are exactly doing what I would do. They're something else, but I think they're extremely powerful and they're engaging with ideas I'm interested in. I think ambiguity is an interesting term, and there is a kind of there can be a negative connotation that you leave all options open and you don't make a decision. And I'm not actually interested in that. I think it's very important, the position that I take vis-a-vis subject within the work is very important for me. So I don't want to be ambiguous in this respect. I want to be very clear how I relate to something and what kind of work I make. But I do want the work to have an openness that is not prescriptive, that there is one reading or one interpretation. I feel very urgent about the things that I'm working with, and I do feel that I want to try to resolve this in a work, or to think about this in a work, to engage with it and to share it through the work with other people. And I do think that this is a kind of necessity, but I also feel that one has to be careful about sort of calling art a necessity vis-a-vis the kind of existential necessities of food and things like that. I guess I enjoy talking to everyone who's passionate about something, and for me that's not necessarily connected with having specialist knowledge. I do enjoy talking to other artists, and which can kind of range from conceptual questions, the meaning of art. Within my work and within the making of the work, I have a lot of conversations with the people that I encounter in various places. And this is really an integral part of the practice. And even though those conversations are not always recorded, or they are recorded but not always within the final work, visible or audible, the conversations are a way for me to engage and to not be in a position where I just speak about something or about someone, but my attitude is that of speaking with someone. Yeah, the documentary is sort of, on the surface of it, seems to be maybe quite an important visual methodology or approach. But for me, I'm not actually interested in the objectivity that might come out of that or that it might provide. For me, it's much more about looking at something quite intensely and showing it almost for what it is, but through the intensity of the gaze and through a quite concentrated framing, producing the possibility that that can show something else more than what it is, or it can show something deeper. And for example, in one of my videos, Remnants of the Future, the documentary sort of approach turns into sci-fi, where we see a place and then that place, and it's sort of quite straightforward, and that place eventually is visited by someone from the future. But in any case, I don't feel that I'm completely outside of it and I just sort of show other people as subjects. I do feel that I'm only interested in it if some kind of complicity exists between me and the people I work with. I'm not sure it's a kind of collaboration as such, because that would mean that they are co-authoring the work. So I think I prefer the term complicity. And I think I'm quite interested in exploring some of these methodologies further that involve other people actively participating in the work, performing perhaps in the work, but not in a traditional sense of them being assigned roles, but through workshops, arriving at kind of scenes or images or something like that. So even though traditionally or for a long time I haven't really worked a lot with actors or with people in this kind of active sense, I think this is something that's starting to appear in my work and might be something that I continue exploring.